Romans chapter 8, I'll go ahead and read our main text, verses 16 through 25. We'll pray and then we'll get into our second session here on this beautiful morning. Romans 8, verse 16 through 25. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Let's pray. Father, what an absolute privilege to not only have 1 hour of teaching to get into your word, but to have another one. And may we never take this time we have for granted, although it might be a mental exercise to study your word. May we give ourselves to it. May we yield ourselves and enlarge our hearts to these things, for they ought to become our lives. To be able to utilize in the details of our lives. And so we thank you that we can gather together here at Twin Cities Grace Fellowship, function as the pillar and ground of the truth, and as we learn and come to the knowledge of the truth, begin to prove those truths in our lives, and not just have knowledge that puffeth up, but have that knowledge proceed forth from the members of our body in love towards you, in love towards our neighbor, in all the many ways in which your word teaches us to love. And as we move toward that, Father, may all the preparatory orientation, establishing foundational work to walk that way and suffer the negative responses that often come along it, may we be strengthened. May we be strengthened by hope. May we be strengthened and from that hope receive a enduring patience and an earnest expecting patience of our future hope and glory in the life that is to come, and that be one of the main reasons why we do what we do as we go after winning Christ, as we saw in the first session, and apprehending that which Christ apprehended us for, and to run the race and to obtain the prize, not of a corruptible crown, but an incorruptible crown, and receive the reward of the inheritance, and be glorified together with Christ, reigning with him in the heavenly places. May these things begin to saturate our being and conform us further to the image of your dear Son, and view the very things that he views, and have his mind, have his heart, all to your honor and glory. So we give you thanks and praise for this time we have to look at these most wonderful things that you ordained before the world unto our glory. It's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Again, we are here in Romans 8, verse 17, and we have taken time to look at these matters. And as always, I hope that this has been some profit and benefit to you. Most assuredly, I hope that it is edifying to you. I also understand that as we deal with these things in general, you might be chomping at the bit to actually get into some meat and detail of the actual passage that we're in. And if that's happening, good. I have us right where we're supposed to be, and have been oriented to these matters, and hopefully we are appreciating them more and more as we go on. We are kind of moving forward now from suffering with him to looking at his peculiar glory, that is, that we may be also glorified together. Again, a lot of things can be qualified as glorious, but this is, out of all his glory, this is unique. And the reason why this is unique, this one is unique, because it is qualified beyond just trusting that Christ died for our sins, was buried, and rose again, and receiving the gift of eternal life, receiving the promise of a new tabernacle, a new house, a new body that we will have, and living in that in the heavenly places for all eternity. The moment we believe, we receive those things. This aspect of His glory, this aspect of the inheritance, is further qualified not just by faith alone, but by suffering with Him. Again, suffering is a byproduct of our walk, our faithful walk after the Spirit. Negative response can come, and this is going to teach us when that negative response comes, how do we suffer? Are we going to faint, or are we going to suffer it the way the world suffers things, or are we going to suffer with Him? We're going to suffer it the way He suffers it, patiently, by the way. That's the whole thrust of this passage here, is verse 25, that we all got to wait for glory. We all got to wait for the life to come. But how are we going to wait? How are we going to suffer with Him? Are we going to do it patiently, or are we going to do it impatiently? And there is a great, great difference. And so that's what we're looking at. In last lesson, we began to define and further boil down what this glorifying together is. We're going to be glorified together with Christ in the sense of having eternal life. We are going to be glorified together with Christ in the sense of having a new body. We are going to be glorified together with Christ in the sense of being in the heavenly places. However, this glorifying together, again, is attached to suffering with Him. And so with that, we're trying to further boil down what kind of glory this is. And what we came to see is that it is in connection with winning Christ. It is in connection with apprehending what Christ has apprehended us for. It is in connection with pressing toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. And what we essentially got to is that there's a prize, there's a crown, it's incorruptible, it has eternal glory attached to it. How it's described is essentially reigning with Christ. That is something we have access to the moment we believe. It's something that we can take hold of, but it's not all something automatically we possess the moment we believe. Or another way, I guess you could look at it, in which Paul kind of describes it, is that we do have it the moment we believe. It's the issue of not being spoiled of it. Let me show you those real quick. First, let me show you the issue of reigning, kind of where we left off last lesson in 2 Timothy chapter 2. And then let me show you that passage where it talks about being spoiled of something. Come with me to 2 Timothy chapter 2 and then get Colossians. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2 first. We've already gone through this passage and described it a little bit last lesson, so I'm just going to pick it up here in verse 11. We started in verse 1, went down to verse 14. We're just going to look at verse 11, one of Paul's faithful sayings, I believe one of five here in what are commonly known as the pastoral epistles. And a saying is a unique way of presenting information. We'll deal with that more when we get into Romans 13. When he talks about a saying in connection with loving your neighbor as yourself. But look at verse 11. He says, "It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself." Now, all of this, he's talking to the elect. He's talking to the believers, those that are already justified unto eternal life. And we know that from the preceding verses, in verses 8, 9, and 10. And the faithful saying here is not denying him in connection with salvation, and he denies the salvation or any of those type of things, but it's denying in connection with reigning. Justification doesn't simply amount to reigning. It gives us access and opportunity to reign with him, but it doesn't equate to the same thing. And that's where we began to qualify more what this glorifying is. And we got a little bit more work to do in connection with it. And what we're going to do is eventually develop this more outside of Paul's epistles, because this is not unique to the dispensation of grace. Where we're going to reign is unique, but the concept of reigning is not unique. Does that make sense? Where we're going to reign is unique to the mystery of Christ, but the general principle of reigning with him, we're going to see this throughout the whole entire scripture. And so reigning is the issue. But look at Colossians. First, let's look at chapter 1. I want you to know something here. I didn't bring it out. I believe last week we were in this passage, and I didn't bring it out because sometimes as you get to deal with this a little bit more meatier doctrine, doctrine. I didn't want someone to mix up, he said meteor? Meteor doctrine, what's that kind of doctrine? But when you deal with it, it's hard because there's so many things that kind of develop it, but I want to provide you some insight to it right now. Look at verse 3 of Colossians 1. It says, if we give thanks, and just keep in mind this issue of this unique, peculiar glory in connection with the hope and connection with these things. Verse 3, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which ye have to all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. It's interesting. Oftentimes when we talk about the heavenly places, we talk about that as our what? As our hope. This one is our hope which is reserved, which is laid up for you in heaven. So part of our hope is heaven, but also there's something that's laid up for us in heaven that is part of our hope. That's what Paul begins to focus on. Not just heaven, but a hope that is in heaven and that is part of the reason why they're loving the saints. They're loving the saints for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. He says, whereof ye heard before in the gospel. Is that what it says? Oh, the word of the truth of the gospel. You ever see those big phrases? Like, what in the world is that? The word of the truth of the gospel. Well, I don't know if you break that all down, but there is something that proceeds from the gospel, some truth, some word of the truth of the gospel. In other words, the gospel, as we know it, Paul's gospel, there's some purpose. There's some word of truth of that gospel. Some truthfulness to why the gospel is given. It's the same concept of Philippians chapter 3 that Christ has apprehended us and we are to apprehend that which for what he's apprehended us for. In other words, he didn't just die on the cross for us to have to have eternal life, even though how great that is. And I don't mean to diminish it at all. But he didn't just die on the cross so that we could have eternal life. If that's the mind we have, we're selling the cross of Christ short. Because he didn't just die so we could have eternal, he died so that we could reign with him in that life. That's the abundance of grace that proceeds from that cross. Not just the simplicity of the cross. The simplicity of Christ is that, but the depth, the glory, the deep things of God is that what also proceeds from that is reigning with Christ. We talk about in Philippians chapter 3 how there's those that are otherwise minded when it comes to that issue and they're enemies of the cross of Christ because they don't see the fullness of what that cross can do. And we saw that also in Philippians, when he dies, he's obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God hath highly exalted him. And he rewarded him with that position. And this hope, which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel. In the gospel, there's the word of truth, the purpose of that gospel. And that is that hope that's laid up for you in heaven. The gospel, in other words, the gospel, believing the gospel, gives you the hope of heaven, but the word of the truth of the gospel provides you a hope that's laid up for you in heaven, if that makes sense. And then he says in verse 6, which is come unto you as it is in all the world. This is part of Paul's message. Now, that's just give them the gospel. He gives them the word of the truth of the gospel after that. And then he says this, and bringeth forth what?
Fruit.
I love that. That hope that is laid up for you in heaven, and he's going to talk about in the rest of Colossians, that's laid up, that's supposed to bring fruit. I said before, that sandwich affects the gratitude of the cross is supposed to push us and motivate us, but also you have the pulling of this hope that's laid up for us in heaven is supposed to bring forth much fruit as well. He says, as it doth also in you since the day ye heard of it, and knew the grace of God. What are those last two words? And in truth. What's the purpose of all the grace of God? Now look at verse, let's move on from there. Come with me to chapter 2. Look at chapter 2, and look at verse 1. It says, for I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you, and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God, and of the Father, and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. For though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so what? Walk ye in him. What's the context now? Their what? Their walk, okay? Rooted and built up in him, established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after who?
Christ.
Spoil you of what? Yeah. You can't be spoiled of your salvation from the debt and penalty of your sins. You could in one sense be spoiled of your security that you are supposed to have. But you can never be spoiled of your position in Christ. But rather something else you can be spoiled of. By the way, you don't have to turn there, but we looked at Philippians chapter 3 when he talked about those many walk of whom I told you often now tell you even weeping that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. Paul's describing them again here for us in Colossians chapter 2. That they spoil because they're after philosophy. The love of wisdom, the wisdom of the world. Philo, love, Sophia, wisdom, the love of wisdom, worldly wisdom, earthly things. Earthly, worldly wisdom gets you earthly and worldly wisdom and riches and profit. We are not to mind those things, but the things which are above. His wisdom. Because he just said in verse 3, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And although they're in him, he provides us to them, provides us those treasures in the Word of God. And all those things are not after Christ. Now look at verse 18. He says, let no man beguile you of your what? Reward. In a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. Got a lot of angel worshiping going on today. Angel fever. And what it is that it's interesting because I don't deny that I don't see something. The issue is what they see is not what they're really seeing. And what they need to understand is that all those things are counterfeit. And he talks about how, when he says, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. And over there in 2 Corinthians, he talks about how Satan has transformed himself as an angel of light. A lot of people seeing angels today. but not from God. And the issue is don't get involved in that stuff. And what it ends up doing is it beguiles you of your reward because you start focusing on that stuff instead of focusing on what you're supposed to be focusing on. Focusing on Christ. Because that stuff, you're not holding the head, verse 19, from which all the body by joints and bands having nourishment ministered and knit together increases with the increase of God. But what I want you to see is that you can be beguiled of your reward. Now, what is that reward? Look at chapter 3. In the context of the servant-master relationship, he says, verse 22, he says, "Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service, not just when they're looking at you as men pleasers, but in singleness of your heart, fearing God." You serve your master because you fear God, not because you fear them. When you fear them, the tendency is only to work when they're watching. But when you fear God and you know what he's watching all the time, you serve all the time in singleness of your heart unto him. And whatsoever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men, knowing. Now he goes right into how you conduct yourself with your master and the nature of your labor to this. Verse 24, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. The reward of the inheritance. The reward that proceeds from the inheritance. He's the one that gives it. And he's the one that gives it, so serve him. See how it's motivating him? See how he wants it to motivate the servant? He wants the servant to think that when he's going to serve his master, I'm serving God because I know from him, he gives the reward of the inheritance. And what I can get from him is a lot better than what I can get from my master right now. In every situation and circumstance, this thing is, he's pressing towards it, and it's pulling him, it's drawing him. Someone who says that you ought not to be motivated by reward doesn't understand you're not being motivated by Christ, because again, he is the reward. Let's move on from here. I just wanted to bring that up to you in connection with possessing it and losing it, or not necessarily having it and attaining it. There's kind of both sides of the coin. The reason why I think that is there is because the Colossians, the Ephesians, and the Philippians are these saints who are faithfully walking after the Spirit, and they're suffering, and they're enduring the suffering. Now, there's some things that Paul still got to correct them on, but they're faithfully obedient to what the Spirit's teaching. You'll see in all of them that their love is abounding one toward another. Paul can hear from afar their love toward one another. He also knows they're suffering, so he's checking up on them, see if they're enduring. They're enduring. And then he brings up this issue of glory. So in one sense, the way he's looking at the Ephesians, the Philippians, and the Colossians is that they possess. It's like if they were all to die, or if the rapture was to take place, they got it. They have taken hold of some things, or they're going to be rewarded because of what they're doing. But the issue is now, Paul's now in a different context with these saints. He's telling them, but you got to beware. Before you had to beware and you could be beguiled, but here too you got to beware and beguiled. But the context is, if you're to die or the rapture is to take place, you're going to get the reward. And if you're beguiled, you could be spoiled of it. You could be beguiled of it. Well, let's begin to go a little bit outside now of Paul's epistles. And I want you to see this same concept of, again, suffering and this glory, but also the uniqueness of this glory. Now remember, we're going to take a look at a few passages here. And when we do, I want you to notice that, and as we've already established it in Romans 8, that walking after the Spirit, that's going to initiate and engage the negative response. Look at that real quick since we're close. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, and just remind ourselves of it. Verse 12. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So you're in Christ, and then the issue is living godly. That's that walking after the Spirit. Eventually, when we get to Romans 12, and now the Spirit's going to give us some instruction, that instruction is in godliness. To think the way God thinks, to live the way God lives, and labor with Him, and spend our time the way in which He instructs us to. And so we're going to, by that instruction, live godly in Christ Jesus, and then the persecution will come. In fact, let me show you that real quick. Look at Romans 12. Paul anticipates this. Look at Romans 12. I always say Romans 12. We ought to esteem Romans 12 as much, if not more. I should say as much, yea, more than many esteem the Ten Commandments. And there's a flow, and there's an order, and there's a sense, and there's a sequence to Romans 12, 13, all of God's Word, but here, especially when you get the instruction, you just have Paul start listing off stuff. And you got commas and semicolons and colons, and long sentences, and the issue is like, man, he's just bringing up stuff, just throwing them out there, just into the air, and we're just supposed to take them and but there's order to it. It's kind of like Proverbs. Proverbs, you think, man, most Christianity just deals with, well, this is just one little proverb here, and here's another one. Solomon's journal and David's journal that they just took some nugget of wisdom that they came and they jotted it down here, and then this here, and you got a whole bunch of unorganized, unsequenced, sayings and proverbs and tidbits. No. That book is so organized. It's so ordered and so structured from chapter 1 to chapter 31. And the same thing here with Paul in Romans 12. But what I want you to see, I want to start in verse 9. And I want you to see a couple things in connection with things that we're going to face and then how the verse tells us how we are to respond to them, and then also what Paul is anticipating. He's already anticipated in Romans 8 that we're going to suffer, we're going to go through tribulation. But now you see it here kind of being played out. Look at verse 9 of Romans 12. It says, "Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is," what? "Evil. Cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love. In honor, preferring one another." Now in those couple verses, from verse 3 down to verse 10, you really haven't left the local assembly. The context that he gives those instructions are with members one of another. But it begins to shift a little bit in verse 11. Not that we can't do business with one another. And there's many ways you can look at business, but how we do business with one another. But when you talk about business, you're really talking about things outside the church. And look at what he says in connection with how we just saw it with the masters and servants in Colossians. About in singleness of her heart, whatsoever you do, do it heartily, not as unto men, but unto God, for knowing that from him you shall receive the reward of the inheritance. Well, that all comes from this verse. Verse 11, not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. But now I want you to notice what comes right on the heels of that verse. So conduct yourself in business, not slothfully. The flip side of the coin of slothful is diligence. We're going to see that eventually we do. Go back to Proverbs, slothful and diligent are always contrary one to another. And we're going to take a look at diligence. And you can learn about diligence all the way back with Adam in the garden. That'll be a fun thing when we do that. A fervent spirit, and then he says, serving the Lord. But when you do that, Paul anticipates something. And he anticipates it because of the next things that he's going to say. They're not, again, just unorganized. He put them in order because of things that we're going to go through. It fits with the doctrine and how they get played out. Look at verse 12. Rejoicing in hope. patient in what?
Tribulation.
Tribulation is going to come when you're not slothful, in business, when you're fervent in spirit and you're serving the Lord. Some measure of tribulation is going to come. And in those situations, you are to rejoice in hope and be patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. Prayer is the means of which you're going to rejoice in hope and produce that patience when you're in the tribulation. And so he anticipates the living godly is going to produce the persecution. And the reason why I brought that all up is because we're going to go to some passages now, and we're going to see the same pattern. We're going to see the same pattern that the faithful walk produces a negative response and then an exhortation to endure it and glory in the life that is to come. And what we're going to begin to do, because our focus, we've already established that, but we're going to begin to look at this glory and the nature of it. We already saw about reigning. Now we're going to see if we can get a testimony of Scripture to validate it. So come with me, if you will, first to Matthew 24. Matthew chapter 24. By the way, and I brought this question up before, but when it says, if so be they suffer with him, that you may be also glorified together. In this connection with his glory, is Christ glorified yet? No. Is he glorified? Yes. We can go through John's gospel this past week and saw many times he talks about he's going to go and be glorified. But this glory, he does not possess yet. He only possesses it when the suffering ends. Suffer and then glory. Now there is glory that, again, he has right now, but not this one. And what is this glory? It's the issue of reigning. Now we know all power has been given unto him, but he's not reigning in that kingdom, and he's not reigning in the heavenly places to the degree in which he's going to be out here, future from us. And what he does is he holds that off for us to participate, be glorified together out there. But that's true also with Israel's program out here, okay? And the reason why I bring that up is because we're in Matthew 24 here. We're in one of these end times passages when, again, the dispensation of grace isn't in view and Christ is focused on the day of wrath and what's going to come after that. And he gives an order and a sequence of events of what's going to transpire through the day of wrath, identifying what Daniel saw was true, and other things in Job are true. And as he asked the question, in fact, he's sitting upon the very mount in which his feet are going to touch when he is going to return to this earth. I always get that question in email. Well, how can you distinguish the rapture between his second coming and his earth? I don't see it in Scripture. Well, it's pretty easy by what the difference between the two. The one is we're caught up together with him in the clouds. The other one, Zechariah, I believe it's chapter 14, he comes and his feet actually touch and it gives the exact mount, the Mount of Olives. And from there, he sends out a prophetic, if you want to call it, a rapture. He sends out his angels to gather his elect from the four winds of the earth. But that's not our resurrection. We're caught up. There he's on the earth, and then he sends them out and he gathers his elect from the four winds of the earth. So it's pretty clear if you just pay attention to the words and what it says and what it doesn't say. But anyways, here he's sitting upon the very mountain which he's going to return, talking about the very things that are going to precede his return to when he returns to things that shortly follow his return. And I want to pick it up here in verse, for time's sake, let's move to verse 26. He says, wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers, believe it not. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. And wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together, because that's going to be a huge slaughtering there. When he returns, he's going to utilize the fowls of the heaven to feast upon the carcasses of the kings who come against him that he's going to destroy. And they also turn upon themselves as well, because it's going to be complete darkness. They're not going to be knowing who they're killing. They're going to be killing one themselves. But anyways, verse 29. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heaven shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great what?
Glory.
Part of this great glory is the establishment of his kingdom. Not only is he going to be decked out in his glorious apparel, and what he's going to be doing in vanquishing his enemy is going to be glorious, behind him, his kingdom coming on earth as it is in heaven, as it coming is going to be glorious. To establish, according to what Daniel talked about, is that when he comes to establish his kingdom, he destroys Nebuchadnezzar's image there, and you have the establishment of his reign forever. The third mandate of the Davidic covenant begins to be fulfilled. You have Redeemer, Deliverer, Avenger, and then he comes to be the King and the Blesser in that kingdom. And there's a 1,000-year installment of that Davidic covenant there before for all eternity, because he's got there's the times of refreshing that come from the presence of the Lord, and the times of restitution of all things in connection with the Davidic covenant. But if you remember 2 Samuel 7, when we looked at that, the issue is the establishment of his throne and the establishment of his kingdom. And that is his reign. And that's part of his great glory. Come with me to Matthew, back up a little bit. Matthew 21. Matthew 21. Hold on one second. Come with me to Matthew 25 first. I don't know why. Oh, there it is. It's just farther down on my notes. Look at Matthew 25 first. Excuse me. Now, Matthew 25 is obviously after Matthew 24. So he's talked about the great glory and the establishment of his kingdom and those kind of things. And now in Matthew 25, he begins to give these parables to the remnant, and you have one from verse 1 to verse 13, which many get confused, but we won't deal with that right now. And then we're going to look at verse 14 and on. I want you to see something. Verse 14, for the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country. That's going to be him. He's going to go. Who called his own servants. Who are they? His own servants, okay? Does he own them? They're his own servants. And delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. Every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same, and made them other 5 talents. So, what I want you to see, just in connection with our pattern that we've established here, is that they're his servants. They're justified, they're his servants. He's given them some things to operate with, and now they are to be faithful and obedient to operate with them. Okay? And look what he says here. Verse 16, then he that received the 5 talents went and traded with the same and made them other 5 talents. Was he pretty diligent with his goods he was given? Mm-hmm. Yes. Verse 17, likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained the other 2. But he that received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. So you have 2 that were diligent with what they did, and 1 was not diligent. Verse 19, after a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them. What is another word that you could describe reckoning?
Crediting to?
Checking up on, yep. Selling?
Accounting.
Accounting.
Agreeing.
Yeah, all that's right. Please don't get me wrong. It's not wrong. I'm looking for a specific word.
Judgment.
Yeah, judgment. Judgment's also part of it. All of the words you guys gave are closer to reckoning than judgment is. But judgment's also part of that. I've come to, he's going to come to reckon, come to make judgment upon what they did with his goods. Okay? Verse 20, and so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliveredest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee what? Ruler over many things. Enter thou into, and underline this. I want you to see some. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Now, what does that individual get? He's already what? A servant. But by doing with the goods that were given to him, being faithful to those goods, the Lord makes him a ruler. And the judgment is absolutely beautiful. The standard of the judgment here. Faithful over a little, few things, I'll make you ruler over much. He goes on, verse 22, and he also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliveredest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid. You see this guy's perspective of his Lord. And went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast, that is thine. His Lord answered and said to him, thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gatherest where I have not strawed. By the way, when he comes, he judges them based upon how he perceived him. This is how you viewed me, and this is what it amounted to, you doing nothing, I am going to reckon you upon that perception. He takes the very same thing of how he viewed him. Okay, you did that, then this is what you get. Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gather where I have not strawed. Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers. And then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. For unto every one that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away that which he hath. And cast ye out the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. That outer darkness is not hell. It's according, you would have already read Matthew 24 when there's this. The sun is going to be darkened. The moon's going to be turned into darkness. The moon's not going to give her light. Stars shall fall from heaven. The outer darkness is another place in the earth, not in that in the light of the kingdom. And by the way, the outer darkness, you go down through the rest of the passage, and it talks about everlasting fire or everlasting punishment. That's a different locale than the outer darkness. Anyways, So you have a profitable servant and an unprofitable servant. Both are servants, but based upon their faithfulness to the goods that were given them, they're going to be either rewarded reigning or not rewarded reigning. Now you might be thinking, well, where's the suffering in all this? Well, it's been established other places in Matthew's gospel. Before we do that, I want you to look over at a similar account. I believe it's in Luke 19. Look at Luke 19. So although we haven't brought suffering into the equation, what we have is a servant, they're justified, the issue of been received something, you're faithful with that something, and then reward. Look at Luke 19. Verse 11, and as they heard these things, he added and spake a parable, because he was nigh to Jerusalem, because they thought that the kingdom of God should immediately appear. Verse 12, he said, therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to see for himself a kingdom and to return. So they think that the kingdom of God is going to immediately appear. He's preparing them that it's not going to immediately appear. But rather, he's going to be gone for a while, but he also places the responsibility upon them of what they ought to do during his absence. To receive for himself a kingdom and to return, verse 13, he called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds and said unto them, occupy till I come. But his citizens, notice there's a difference between the citizens and the servants, but his citizens hated him and sent a message after him saying, we will not have this man to reign over us. And it came to pass that when he was returned, having received the kingdom, then he commanded these servants to be called unto him, to whom he had given the money, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came, by the way, remember Proverbs chapter 3, about happy is the man that findeth wisdom, happy is the man that findeth understanding, for the merchandise of it is better than that of gold and silver. The wisdom and understanding that they get from their Lord, they're supposed to take that and utilize it in trading, in merchandising, getting it out, proving it, and going to manifest and display it and utilize in certain situations. And here he's coming to see what they've done. Look at verse 17. And he said unto him, verse 16. Then came the first saying, Lord, thy pound have gained 10 pounds. And he said unto him, well, thou good servant, because thou hast been faithful in a very little, thou authority over 10 cities. Sound like reigning? The second came, saying, Lord, thy pound hath gained 5 pounds. He said likewise to him, be thou also over 5 cities. And another came, saying, Lord, behold, here is thy pound, which I have kept laid up in a napkin. For I feared thee, because thou art an austere man. Thou takest up that thou layest not down, and reapest that thou didst not sow. Which again is just, that's not the right thinking. They're not thinking about things properly. Verse 22, and he saith unto him, out of thine own mouth will I judge thee, thou wicked servant. Thou knewest that I was an austere man, taking up that I laid not down, and reaping that I did not sow. Wherefore then gavest not thou my money into the bank, that at my coming I might have required mine own with usury. And he said unto them that stood by, take from him the pound and give it to him that hath 10 pounds. And they said unto him, Lord, he hath 10 pounds. And I say unto him, that unto every one which hath shall be given, and from him that hath not, even that he hath shall be taken away from him. But those thine enemies, which would not that I should reign over them, the citizens of verse 14, but hither and slay them before me. So the servants, even the wicked servant, he doesn't slay. But his enemies, his citizens, who say, we're not going to have him reign over us, those he slays. So there's a difference there. But look at now, come back with me. Now, where does suffering come into play? Well, he began to establish that earlier on in the ministry. Look at Matthew chapter 5. Go over to Matthew chapter 5. We've already looked at some of this, but many, many times the Lord prepares his greater crowd of disciples, and more specifically, his smaller crowd of apostles, that they were going to suffer. But look at what he attaches all that to. Look at Matthew 5, pick it up here in verse 10. It says, blessed are they which are persecuted for what? Righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So they're being persecuted, but for righteousness' sake. They're putting the righteousness he's going to give them specifically, not their imputed righteousness, but the righteousness, not the pseudo-righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, but the righteousness he's going to give them and teach them, and as they participate in that teaching, they're going to produce that righteousness, and then they're going to suffer for it. He says, verse 11, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. And that's, we're going to eventually see some of that, the testimony of Scripture, that even the prophets of old, they're persecuted for preaching righteousness and for doing righteousness, and they're going to receive a reward. Look at, come over to chapter, chapter 5, verse 43. Some of these we looked at already, but now I want you to see the reward, that the same pattern outside of Paul's epistles, and we've already seen some of those passages in connection with reigning and ruling over someone, and now we're throwing in the issue of suffering into the equation outside of Paul's epistles. Verse 43, ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. By the way, this one, again, does not say for righteousness' sake or falsely for his name, even though that's what's behind it. This one is a little bit more not so directly clear as far as why one is being persecuted, even though they might know. This one's not as clear, whereas before, earlier on in the chapter, you're being persecuted for righteousness' sake. You're being persecuted for his name. This one is almost like in your day-to-day dealings, and you just deal with people that just don't like you, not necessarily for righteousness' sake, whatever it is, they don't like you. This is how you deal with them. It says that you may be, verse 45, that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven, for he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. For if ye love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? But even in this context of persecution, they can participate in the reward. Verse 47, if ye salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans so? Be therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven, perfect. There's many more, but we're gonna move on. Well, let's look at one more because our time is already dwindling. Come with me to Hebrews chapter 2, and then we'll pick this up next week in the first session. Hebrews chapter 2. We got to get Hebrews 2, and we got to get Isaiah 53. And let's look at Isaiah 53 first. When we talk about the sufferings of Christ and the glory to follow in regards to Christ himself, there's still sufferings that he's going through now that are different from the cross. But in connection with that, I want you to see that what was held out to him was a reward as well. And that was that position of sitting at the Father's right hand. In fact, you got to get one more passage. I know I shouldn't do this, but look at Psalm 16. Psalm 16, and then we'll hit Isaiah 53, and then we'll hit Hebrews 2. Psalm 16, and for the sake of time, just look at verse 11. It's in the context of resurrection. Verse 10 is probably a very common verse for you. Look what he says here in verse 11. He says, thou wilt show me the path of life in connection with resurrection. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy, what? Right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Two things there. In connection with the path of life, there's the presence is fullness of joy, and at thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Two things. And what Christ is going to get based upon his faithful obedience unto death, even the death of the cross, is he's going to get that right hand. He's going to get that position. I'm on my left. He's going to get that position at the Father's right hand. And he does that by faithful obedience unto death, even the suffering. Now look at Isaiah 53. You know Isaiah 53 is a very common passage in connection with the sufferings of Christ and the crucifixion and those kind of things that we now know. We could go through a lot of it, but for time's sake, just pick it up here in verse 10. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. That's the concept of propitiation. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him, it's going to be the Christ, a portion among the great. With the great. And he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul into death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he shall bear the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. That portion is the Father's right hand. And among the great is the among. With the great and with the strong are those of old. Hebrews 11 picks up on that. So great a cloud of witnesses like Abraham and Enoch and Abel and Isaac and Jacob and David, all those great ones. Well, he gets a portion, and the portion is above every other portion. It's the right hand of the Father. Now look at Hebrews 2. Hebrews 2. Pick it up here in verse 9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, by the way, see how that grace of God, he suffered, he went through the suffering of death and was crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. For it became him, for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto what? This is the little flock here. They're the sons of God. And the issue is, they're going to participate in glory, a new body, and eternal life, and all this. He's not talking about that. This is in view of suffering. Bringing many sons unto glory. There are his sons, and he wants to bring them unto this peculiar glory. And he says here, and bring many sons, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through what? Sufferings. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one. For which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee, and again I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children which God hath given me. For as much then as children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. And then he goes on and talks about some other things. But that issue of make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings is the issue of him doing it and them participating in it and bringing them unto this glory. And you see that all throughout the general epistles, the Hebrew epistles. But I'm going to have to stop there, and we'll have to pick it up next time. But anytime you see the issue of suffering and glory attached to suffering, especially in the context of teaching that to a group of people, you're not just talking about eternal life. You're not just talking about a new body. You're not just talking about glory in connection with the kingdom. You're talking about suffering-based glory, and that peculiar glory has to do with reigning. By the way, we didn't even deal with it, but when Christ, I'll just give you this, but when Christ is going up to Jerusalem to go die on the cross, And James and John came. In fact, it was their mother, says, because they thought that, again, the kingdom of God was going to immediately appear. She comes along and she wants to get in, and she says, "In your kingdom, let my son sit at thy left and thy right hand in your kingdom." And he says, "Those aren't mine." He says, "Are they able to be baptized with the baptism that I'm going to be baptized with?" They don't know what he's talking about. And they say, and they say, "Yes, we are." And he goes, "Yes, you are." And it's suffering unto death. And he says, "It's in my Father's hand to give." But the qualification of that left and right hand, what's attached to it, is suffering. And then the glory. They are going to sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. This is another throne that they could occupy. And it had to do with suffering and glory. They're already his, besides the son of perdition, Judas. But the 12 there. And by the way, that left and right hand could be given to someone not the 12, by the way. It could be given to someone who suffers suffers, and then possibly whatever that qualification of suffering is, under death or whatever it may be, that's what that's there. And so when you see that, you're dealing with that unique or that peculiar glory. And I encourage you to read through Hebrews through Revelation. Especially, you can hunker down in 1st and 2nd Peter. Peter talks about all over the place about the trying of their faith and the sufferings they're going to go through and how they should respond in those sufferings. And what and when they go through that, the Spirit of glory resteth upon them. Because they have in view the very thing that Christ had in view, for the glory that was set before him, endured the cross, despised the shame, and he is set at the Father's right hand, Hebrews 12. And that's that very same peculiar glory that can motivate us to go through our walk and suffer the consequences of it as well. Because that glory, when you get your mind around it, even to some small measure, there's nothing compared to it on this earth. Nothing. Not even suffering. You'll get the perspective. When you start to get your mind around that glory, you'll start to get the perspective Paul had in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. "For this light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for me exceeding eternal weight of glory." He looked at all the sufferings, not only what he was presently going through, but what he had gone through, what he potentially was going to go through, and he says, "It's light. It's light compared to that glory." And this affliction actually works for that glory. It's a privilege. It's a privilege to be able to have what he's given us. And as I said before, may we start to see what this glory is, not with our physical eyes, but with the eyes of our understanding. Because it's that. What Paul is going to start to get accomplished as we move on to verse 18 and 19 and 20 is to start look at that glory, start look at our hope, so that when we go through the sufferings, that we start to operate upon the eyes of our understanding and not our physical eyes, and not start to faint under the pressure and sink under the suffering, but rather endure patiently and experience that patience that he has because of what he's looking forward to is that glory. We can have that same mindset and be conformed into the image of Christ in that way. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time to get into your word, to begin to develop even just a little bit further this peculiar glory of reigning with Christ. Such a prospect humbles us, at least it ought to. Yet, a prospect that you hold out to us, nonetheless. We thank you for this opportunity, Father. And if we just walk after the Spirit as we learn the things that he teaches in your word, and we begin to apply them in our lives, we don't have to worry about how much we suffer or what we suffer. That's not the issue. The issue is faithfulness in our walk. That's the overall issue. And when we do that, the glory and the reward will take care of itself. So may our minds be focused on that glory. And if they're focused on that glory, then they're going to be focused on our walk and what we're doing now. And if it's focused on our walk, then it's going to be focused on the things of the Spirit. And it's going to be focused on learning those things of the Spirit. It's going to be focused on studying, reading your word, and getting to understand it, and then applying it. So, Father, we thank you for your word, that we can participate in this wonderful prize that you hold out to us, and the very reason why you have apprehended us. We thank you over and over and over again. I thank you for these saints and the absolute joy it is. Paul talked about the Philippians as his crown of rejoicing, because they had a mutual faith in these things. They had a like-mindedness in these things. And the joy it is to begin to develop this mind with the saints here, so that we could, one of another, be our crown of rejoicing as we begin to manifest your love to one another, as we begin to manifest godliness to one another each and every time we see each other, each and every time we meet, for your honor and glory, and be able to refresh one another and encourage one another as we go out and manifest godliness in different aspects of our lives. We do pray, if someone is here listening, if they have not trusted how that Christ died for their sins, was buried, and rose again, that they would believe that good news, that he died on the cross to pay for the debt and penalty of their sins. He rose again to be able to offer that payment for their sins as a free gift to them. The way in which they receive this free gift is not by being baptized, not by raising a hand, coming down an aisle, giving the tithe, going to church, doing any kind of good works that they could do in themselves, but by receiving it by faith and faith alone. And the moment God sees their faith trusting in what Christ did, he'll justify them unto eternal life, meaning he'll forgive them all their sins, past, present, future, impute his righteousness unto them, and they will possess, therefore, the gift of eternal life. May they believe this very moment. And we thank you for this time of grace giving. In Christ's name, amen.